By now, we know what a sigma algebra is, and we even saw some examples and properties. So now what we're gonna do is learn about a very particular sigma algebra called the Borel sigma algebra. And this one is, we're gonna see it in the real numbers, but at the end of the video, I'm gonna leave just an intuition for those of you who know topology of a way in which we can define the sigma algebra, the Borel sigma algebra, over just any set X. If you don't know about topology, then don't worry. In this reproduction list, knowing it for the real numbers will be more than enough. We know that we'll be using the sigma algebras to generalize this definition of volume, this measure. And Borel sigma algebras are really good because they give us a particular type of measures called Borel measures. We'll see these in later videos, but basically Borel measures have very nice properties that makes them very easy to work with. Okay, let's go ahead and define the Borel sigma algebra. It is the sigma algebra generated by open sets. So a few things to notice here. Generated, well, if you don't remember what this is, then just go to the previous video. And the notion of open sets, well, an open set in general in any space X with a metric, so every time we say open set, we are saying that we have either a topology or a distance. And in this case, we're going to be talking about distances. Obviously, the same applies for topologies, but or by topologies in use by metrics. But let's just consider we are thinking about the real numbers with the usual distance. And what we know is that for each distance, we are able to define these sets called balls. And balls are centered in some element X and have a radius R. And there's just the points, in this case in real numbers, for which the distance between the center of the ball and this point is smaller to R. Okay, this is a definition of a ball. This is just a quick recap for those of you who don't remember. And so we say that an open set, let's say A, is an open set if for every X in A, there exists a radius R for which the ball with center in X and radius R is completely contained in the set A. Okay, so this is the definition of open set. So what we do is we gather every open set in the real line and create the sigma algebra generated by that family of open sets. And that sigma algebra that we get will be the Borel sigma algebra. Let's dive a bit deeper into the Borel sigma algebra to have more intuition on what it actually is. So we have this proposition. It says that this is the Borel sigma algebra, in this case is over R, that the Borel sigma algebra is generated by each of these sets. Some books even consider some of these as directly the definition of a Borel sigma algebra. In our case, we say that it's the sigma algebra generated by open sets, and then from that we can conclude that it's actually generated by the open intervals, the closed intervals, half open, open rays, and closed rays. And these sets just have this notation we're going to be using. E1 is going to be the set of open intervals, E2 closed intervals, and so on. Half open intervals have these two ways of representation because they can be closed and open in the left or in the right. The same with open rays, the infinity can be either negative infinity or positive infinity. And then the closed ray is the same, but we have now here that the A is included in the set. So what this proposition is saying is the sigma algebras generated by each of these sets is the same as the one generated by open sets. We're not gonna prove this, we're just gonna talk a bit about how one would go ahead and prove it. So the thing that's important is First, we should be able to prove this first one, okay? And now, open sets in the real line can be written as a numerable union of open intervals. Okay, what I'm saying is, any set of this form that satisfies this definition, any set A that's open in the real line, can be written as a union of numerable open intervals. If A is open, A a subset of R, then there exists a sequence of the form open intervals A sub I, B sub I, from I equals 1 to infinity, so a numerable sequence of open intervals, such that A is exactly, so this is not just a cover of the set A, is exactly the union from I equals 1 to infinity of AI BI. This is a property that I'm not gonna prove. It's actually quite hard to prove. You have to define an equivalence relation and work with it. We're not gonna prove it here, it's not the objective, but we have this property, we know it exists. So as we can write any open set of a union of intervals, then you can see why this Borel sigma-Algebra can actually also be generated by open intervals. Because for every open set, I can just write that open set as a union of open intervals, and then that union would be generating my sigma-Algebra. But what about the rest? With some intuition, you were able to believe that A is true. Well, but what about the other ways of writing intervals? For example, let's look at the half-open intervals. An interval of the form A, B, that's open in A and closed in B, can be written as the intersection of these intervals, A. So the only thing we actually want to fix in here is this, okay? We want to be able to write this as open intervals in a way. And so what this is, it's going to be the intersection of open in A and B plus 1 over N open. The intersection from N natural numbers. Okay, so we're going to start with B plus 1, then B plus 1 half, B plus 1 third, and so on, getting closer and closer to B with open intervals. What we're doing is we're taking the real line and say, okay, so this one is A, and if B is here and I want it closed, then approximate B with B plus something and always open. We can see that these sets are actually getting closer to B. And obviously the same thing will work for any of the others. The closed interval, we can think of any open interval AB as the union from N equals 1, from N in the natural numbers, of these closed sets, A plus 1 over N and B minus 1 over N. So now what we're doing is very similar. So if this is A and here is B, we are getting closer to, and we want to get the open interval, right? We want to get like this and like this. We are getting closer to this by just getting inside. So A plus 1 over N is gonna be somewhere here, and B minus 1 over N is gonna be here. And then when N is bigger, we are getting closer like this. And always with closed intervals. So if we can write any open interval as a union of closed intervals, then again, I'm sure you'll believe me if I tell you that now closed intervals also will generate my Borel sigma-Algebra. Well, and then for the open and closed rays, it's gonna be the same, only with when it's open, it's very simple. You just take this infinity to be just a number n and take the union when n tends to infinity, and you're done. The same for minus infinity, taking minus n. And for the closed race, what you have to do is, on the closed extreme, you take something like a plus 1 over n, or in this case, a minus 1 over n. And on the other extreme, the infinity one, you would take n and minus n, and just let n go to infinity. So those are very simple. I'm going to leave it for you to think about them and to write them down. And now it comes the part where we finished. We know, we understand the Borel sigma algebra. We can just think of it as this one. The one generated by open intervals is the most intuitive one. So it's going to be intersections, unions, complements of open intervals. But now it comes the moment when we say, okay, it's fine. We know how to work with this one. But what about just the Borel over any set X? Well, if you know a thing or two about topology, let's say that you have X and D, a metric space, then we know every metric space induces a topology. And the topology is going to be the one induced by open sets with this metric. So the definition for open set, it's the same as last one, only X and Y would be elements of X instead of the real numbers. And then when you gather all those open sets in the topology, you can say, okay, my Borel over X, it's gonna be degenerated by the topology. And that's it. And you have, well, actually, once you have topology, you also get a notion of what compact means. And so you can prove that it's also going to be the sigma algebra generated by compact sets in your topology. But that's it for today. I'm not going to dive more into that because it's better to leave it for another reproduction list about topology.